Okay, so the evolution. Let's start with evolutionary scenarios. You are probably familiar with that because that's not specific to herbivores, but generally to evolution of two lineages which somehow interact. You can have host and parasite, in this case a herbivore, which can be co-speciating. So you can see clearly every split of the lineage is in parallel and the same time, and so you end up with ideally mirror-like phylogenies for the host lineage and for the herbivorous lineage here. Then you can have host shifts, and they can be principally in two different ways. One can be that the host shift happens at a different time than the speciation of the plants, but follows the phylogeny. So when this is shown here, yeah, so basically the close related plants are colonized sooner than the more distant related plants, and so you get the same that's this one, yeah, so you get the same topography. You get the same topography, but different time axis. You will get shortened time axis for herbivores, but then the topography is the same because the colonization mirrors phylogeny. This looks like a very strange coincidence, but it's actually not, as long as the factors which are important for colonization by herbivores have a strong phylogenetical signal. If the plants are chemically related plants are chemically similar, then no wonder then the independent colonization at the later stage actually follows the similarity and therefore follows the original evolution, which is long gone. But then you can also have shifts which are coming independent of the phylogeny of the hosts, and so you end up with a different topographies. Now, where we find genuine plant insect coevolution? Of course, it can be anywhere, but when we look at the scenarios, it's actually pretty rare. And one of the systems which has high propensity to coevolution is the combined herbivory pollinating system, where the insect pollinates flowers and then oviposite on some of these flowers. And so the larvae, the progeny of that pollinating insect will depend on development of seeds of that pollinated plant. So basically only the progeny, only the next generation of successfully pollinating pollinating insects will survive, because if the pollination is not successful, then there will be no further development of that flower, and then all the progeny of that mistakenly pollinating insects will die. So that's a strong mechanism which will keep pollinators specialized, and that means that there is a very close relationship between host plant and the species of the herbivore, which is at the same time the pollinator. And so if there is a split in plant lineage, it's likely followed by split in the pollinators. These systems are not very common. The most famous one are between ficus, fig trees, and their agaonidae pollinating wasps. There are also yucca and Eponometridae, small moths which are pollinating them, and then there is Troreus in Czech upolin, and Anthomidae flies. That's one of the temperate zone system, and then another tropical one is Glochidium trees, and again a small lineage of small moths, Gracilaridae, of the genus Epicephala. So, for instance, when we look at the ficus and different species. This is the phylogeny of fig species, and this is phylogeny of their pollinating wasps, where there are statistically significant number of co-speciations, where except for one shift, it's perfectly mirroring the evolution of ficus and the pollinating wasps. This is the broader issue. This is a more recent, much bigger phylogeny, where There is a very close correspondence between pollinating wasps and ficus trees. Ficus is the largest genus of trees in the world, so there is a lot of material for that kind of study. Okay, how this happens? You can have a co-speciation where the lineage of ficus splits, for instance, because of a geographic barrier, and that splits also the pollinators, as opposed to shifts which can be either following a formal phylogeny or across the phylogeny. And when we look at these two phylogenies and look at speciation events and their timing, then there is indeed the estimate, molecular-based estimate for the split between fig wasp lineages is pretty much corresponding to the timing of splitting of the ficus host. So we can be reasonably sure that this is the scenario which we can observe in most of the ficus and fig wasp development. Apart from this co-speciation scenario, there is also a more general scenario of much sort of loose, more loose coevolution, which does not necessarily end up with perfect mirror phylogenies, and that is the reciprocal escape and radiation and radiate coevolution. The idea is that if a plant lineage suddenly evolves a new defense mechanism, like first the yellow here and later the orange here, then it escapes for a time, it escapes from pressure by herbivores and therefore speciates faster, can occupy new habitats, can have faster speciation, which is shown here by shorter branches. But of course, later on, with some delay, herbivores will find some way how to overcome this defense, and then they colonize the empty herbivore-free lineage, and then it's herbivores which are catching up and speciating fast until there is yet another phylogenetical discovery of defense, and the whole process repeats itself. This is, of course, a bit idealized and simplified version, because in reality there are so many herbivorous lineages. Some of them might be resistant against this new defense invention and be able to overcome it immediately. Some of them not, and so on. But as a principle, could be working. We can also see sometimes on the plant phylogeny these signs of continuing defense improvements. So, for instance, this is a relationship between Asclepias and their cerambycid beetles, which is fairly close in terms of phylogenies. But you can see that these Asclepias plants are basically poisonous. They have cardenolides, and again, there is a degree of chemical sophistication throughout the evolution. So starting with simple cardenolides and then getting them more complex, more toxic, and then further developing them in terms of toxicity, complexity, and also here concentration in the latex. So there is some kind of escalation in defense. Of course, when we look at the community level phylogenies, this is Swiss Alps temperate zone ecosystem, where we have all the butterflies, all butterfly species feeding on 231 most abundant plant species. And so you have the phylogeny and of the plants and butterflies and their trophic interactions. And so when you look at it, then obviously there is a very strong phylogenetic signal. For instance, this lineage of nymphalids feeding on the monocots, and then you have Brassicaceae with pieris and so on. So there are some general trends, but at the same time, there can be a lot of unexplained variability on the species level. This is illustrated by this study of the Blepharida beetles on Bursera plants. That's a dry area, dry tropical area with trees like that. Bursera is chemically defended, and there can be, this is the phylogeny. This is the phylogeny of Bursera, and against it phylogeny of the beetles feeding on it. And you can see that these trophic interactions are messy. The phylogeny of beetles is not following the phylogeny of their host plants. There is a lot of shifts, okay? But when we look at the chemical profiles of Bursera and we do a phenetic clustering of the plants based on different defense syndromes, which are here shown in different colors, then first we see that defenses are phylogenetically flexible. So, you know, you have some, like the green syndrome here is limited to one plant lineage, but there is a lot of reversals to different systems. And then suddenly there are also green species somewhere unrelated and so on. So first it's phylogenetically flexible. And second, it explains better the host preference of the beetles than the phylogeny. So, and this is actually quite common situation that plant defenses can be quite flexible, and that's what can be predictive more than the phylogeny of the host. This is this is another example of Asclepias, again chemically defensed plants, and their phylogeny. And again, the plants were classified by different types of defenses, latex, cardenolites, trichomes as a mechanical defense, toughness of the leaves, carbon to nitrogen ratio. Again, the higher, the more plant is defended, water content, and the specific leaf area. And based on multivariate analysis of these features, there are basically three types of defense. We have three clusters of plants. One is plants with soft leaves, many trichomes, and high latex content. Then second one, we have tough leaves, low water content, and medium latex. And then we have soft leaves, low latex, and high cardenolites. And when we map these three different colors, for some reason the blue one here change into orange one, but anyway, when we map different strategies, then there is a lineage with a consistent strategy C, soft leaves, low latex, and higher cardenolites, but for the rest of the lineages, again, there is a lot of evolutionary flexibility. And so when we look at the molecular cladogram of the phylogeny of Asclepias, and when we look at this clustering of different defenses, you can see that there is a lot of evolutionary flexibility. So for instance, two sister species in this study, Asclepias enoteroides and variegata, are very far from one another on the defense phenogram, one with the strategy B, tough leaves, low water context, medium latex, other soft leaves, low latex, high cardenolites, completely different strategy. Another example, this is Inga, that's a very species diverse genus of shrubs in the tropical, in the neotropical rainforest. And again, there is a phylogeny of Inga species and the phylogeny of their caterpillars from three different Lepidoptera lineages, Galechioids, Rhyodinids, and Arabidae, which is Rhyodinids are lineage of butterflies, others are Galechioids, are microlabs, and Arabidae is basically partly Noctuidae family in the past. And then you have what they call defensogram, that's basically phenetic clustering of plants based on their defenses. And again, when you look which one is more consistent with herbivorous phylogeny, then it's typically the defenses. And so when we have similarity in herbivorous communities, species composition between all pairs of Inga plants, then there is a correlation with phylogeny, and then there is a correlation with defenses, but it's better correlation with defenses. At the same time, there is some consistency. For instance, this is example of herbivores feeding originally on Asclepiadaceae and Apocynaceae, which are latex rich. And these are instances of long distance jumps to different phylogenetically unrelated plants as acquired host plants. And you see that the jumps to latex-rich lineages, which are here in green, are more frequent than those which don't have latex. So basically, these herbivores are used to latex, and so they tend to colonize unrelated plants again with latex. Now, chemistry of plants is quite complicated, and it's really, you know, sometimes we are sort of not really understanding what's going on, because we might have a wrong ideas about which of the endless numbers of chemicals in plants are relevant to herbivores. So it's only recently where we are getting, you know, into grips with the whole chemical diversity of plants. So for instance, this is a phenogram. This is a clustering based on chemical similarity for 13,000 of different foliar metabolites, which was found in plants from 6 forests in the United States. And so, you know, just showing the diversity of chemistry, and, you know, it's everybody's guess which ones are really important for herbivores and which ones are not. Likewise, this is again a chemical analysis of two locations, one in temperate zone, Maryland, United States, and one in Barro Colorado Island in Panama, this tropical forest. And there are ways where you can classify the similarity in chemical composition of these metabolites. And so this is sort of, again, tree of chemical similarity, where every dot is one of the compounds, and they are linked based on some rules of their similarity. And you have highlighted where they are coming from, whether three species from large genera or others, and either from Panama or the temperate zone, or in both forests. So you can see lots of colors mixed. And when you look at the ordination of smaller number of 185 tree and shrub species mixed from both locations. Here the temperate zone are gray and tropical are black. Then this is the ordination based on their chemical components. And you can see that even between the tropics and temperate zone, you don't have a clear separation of these species. Also, when you look at actually plant taxonomy, these are Inga, Ocotea, Piper, and Psychotria. These are large genera of tropical shrubs. And again, you would expect that they would be somehow chemically consistent being clustered in one place, and that's not happening. They are all over the place. So even the same genus can provide a very, very large chemical diversity. And that's also why when you look at phylogeny of the plants and their chemical composition, for instance, for tropical study, they did not find a significant relationship between phylogenetic distance and chemical similarity. Once you start looking at tens of thousands of compounds, of course, if you pick up like latex, you can say yes, there is some phylogenetic signal in latex plants. But once you start dealing with the whole diversity, then there was no phylogeny signal. It was slightly different for the Maryland, where there was a correlation, so that phylogenetically more distant plant species were also less similar chemically than those which were more related, but not the case for the tropics. So we have basically, when we look at the response of plants against herbivores, then we can see two principally different responses to herbivory. One is escalation. So that means there is some kind of defense, for instance, a chemical, a cardenolid, which for instance, is used by Asclepia as a poisonous secondary metabolites against herbivores. And there is simply escalation of that trait throughout the evolution. So we are getting novel variants. There can be an improvement in efficiency, and basically the cardenolide anti-herbivory machinery is improving as the evolution goes, and the herbivores either are catching up with these improvements or not, and that defines how it will all be working. So for instance, this is sort of showing how the trait will then be developing along the timeline of the evolution. So for instance, here we can see that phenolics in this graph are escalating, at least in dry mass. That's not necessarily the only response. There can be also chemical diversity with increasing age of the speciation. We are getting lower and lower concentrations, and so that means that the more recent speciation associated with higher concentrations, and so there is an escalation of the trait. Another option is divergency. So the point of that is that in the local communities, there is typically an advantage for the plant to be different from the others, because that makes it harder to be used together with other plants. It makes it more difficult to jump on it from either related or unrelated other plants with similar chemistry or similar means of defense. And so the response is not focused on the absolute traits of that plant, how much cardenolides, for instance, there is, but more on being as much different from the others, from other plants which are sharing the same environment, the same community as possible. That is, of course, context dependent response, and so it's more tricky. When we are looking again at some examples, then Inga is a tropical shrub lineage with lots of species. And again, as we have seen already, when you look at the phylogeny against the similarity of chemistry, then there is a lot of phylogenetic noise. So that means plants are fairly flexible in how they are chemically defended. And when we look at the phylogeny, then there is actually no common pattern. We can look at the community composition and see whether it's drawn randomly from the phylogeny or whether it's phylogenetically clustered. So that means more related species are more likely to be in the same community, or over dispersed. That means that related species are less likely to be in the same community. And it looks like two locations, Peru and Panama, are giving significant but very different results. Basically, Peru is clustered, so that phylogenetic dispersion is significantly lower than random, and Panama is over-dispersed. That shows the problems when you are too eager and you study your problem in more than one location, then you get results like this. But when you look at the defense trait dispersion, again, looking whether the plants are more similar chemically than at random or less similar, then there is over dispersion at both sites. Again, it's only two sites, but it's an indicative that that's more important than phylogeny, and the plants are trying to be different when they coexist. This is a similar study of our colleague Martin Wolf and his team on ficus, fig trees in New Guinea. And again, there are different defensive characteristics. There are proteases, there is alkaloids, either concentration or diversity, polyphenols, specific leaf area, and so on and so on. And we can test the development of each of these traits along the fig phylogeny. And then when we look at the local communities of fig trees, we can see whether the traits are significantly under dispersed or over dispersed regarding the composition of local communities. And it looks like typically these are the red bars here, which are significant. They are typically going towards negative values. So that means that they are, the species are significantly less similar than you would expect when they share the same communities in these traits. Of course, the herbivores are also responding to either escalation or divergence. And so sometimes it's possible that certain secondary metabolites, which worked well in the past, becomes useless. After all, we see that also with our medicines, antibiotics losing potency, resistance develops with pathogens, parasites. So the same happens with insects towards plants. Again, Martin Wolf's study on willows in the Central Europe found that willows are well known for salicylates as their secondary protective metabolites. They do work typically. Some of the insects like this chrysomelid, Melasoma populi, are actually aposomatically colored because they are sequestering it for their own defense, which of course is one problem for willows, because then it clearly is not working to their benefit. But also, interestingly, some lineages lost salicylate during the evolution. You can see that on this phylogeny. And when you look at the intensity of herbivory, that means the damage to the leaves, then there is no difference between those with salicylates and without them. They do impact the composition of herbivorous communities. So there is a strong association of different insect species with salicylates, but that's doesn't really interest plant. What is relevant feature for the plant is whether it's eaten less or more, and looks like having salicylate does not make any difference. It takes some energy to synthesize it, and then the plants may actually not bother doing that because it's not really helping. And that's exactly what some plants, some willows, started doing, and so they lost salicylates. There is also another consideration, and that is whether these kind of developmental phylogenetic races where plants are getting into very specialized defense and the herbivores are trying to catch up, whether this is evolutionary dead end, which means that it leads to more narrow and narrow specialization. And once you are specialized, then there is no way to get out of it. So that's what we mean by that end, that then you will forever be specialized to that lineage of host plants, for instance, because as I mentioned, you can, for instance, draw the defensive chemicals from that plant. Well, this is an interesting study showing that it's not necessarily the case. There are Chrysomela beetles, which are dependent for antipredator defense on salicylates from salicase hosts. And so you have the in green here. These are for the Chrysomela. This is the phylogeny of Chrysomela species with their outgroup. And then you can see that they are limited. They are limited in phylogeny to the green lines, not expanding to the hosts with monoterpene iridoids as their main defense. So once willows have salicylates, then that's a good host for Chrysomela. But then there is a lineage of Chrysomela which broke free from these constraints and which developed a new defense, butyric acid, and so that also freed the Chrysomela from dependency on willows. And so on the left hand you have the different colors are showing the defense mode, and so the blue element is the butyric acid, and then on the right hand you have host plants, and so in the black was willows, salicaceae, and then this new development allowed the lineage of Chrysomela beetles to break free from dependency on salicaceae and expand the host range to a new tree family, Berchis, Betulaceae. Now, when we look at either defense features of plants or the counter defense or other species traits of herbivores, we are always interested in how strong is phylogenetical signal. So that means how that trait is fixed phylogenetically and difficult to change. We have seen that lots of aspects of chemistry are fairly flexible. There are some examples from the side of herbivores. These are cynipid wasps, which are gall makers. That's interesting because gall makers are not just feeding on plants. They have to very finely manipulate plants to actually produce the gall, because that's plant tissue which is producing it. So there is a lot of specialization to be able to do that. And so you can see that there is a fair amount of conservatism in the host plant family. So this is the generic genus level phylogeny of cynipids, and you can see that once they develop, once they colonize certain plant lineage, then they to stick with it, but not absolutely. There are reversals and there are acquisitions of new plants even on the family level, which is shown here. Another such consideration for gall wasps, there are actually second largest radiation of gallers. There are about 1300 species, and a huge part of them is on oaks. So this is sort of a very fixed radiation which can then exploit different parts of the plant. So this phylogeny of cynipids is showing plant parts, so how specific they are to them. And so fruit, seed, or flower is in yellow, and then there were jumps to stems and twigs, and also some other plant parts, rarely leaves. And so there is this big phylogenetical dependency on oaks. And when we look at herbaceous hosts, which is a minority, then within the herbaceous host there is similarly huge focus on Asteraceae. There is also some phylogenetical conservatism in morphology of galls. This is again, these are cynipid gallers from one genus, Andricus, on oaks. And so this is a one level lower phylogeny of oaks, and looking at the morphology, and it's clear that there are clades which can be morphologically fairly well recognized by their galls. But it's not always like this, especially when it comes to different guilds. We already mentioned that herbivores have different ways of using their host plant. We have externally feeding, we have leaf miners which are tunneling in the leaves, we have gallers manipulating chemistry of plants to produce galls. We have boring insects either in shoots or in stems. Then we have species rolling the leaves and eating on the leaves, on the fruits, and then even in the leaf petiole, which is very specialized habit. And so all this is what sawflies, another group of herbivores, can do. And when you look at their phylogeny, then there is actually a surprising level of changes of the fly style. Yes, there is a very strong phylogenetical signal. For instance, there is an entire lineage of leaf miners, which are really sticking to leaf mining, and there is the original big lineage of external feeders. But then, still considering how huge change it is in terms of morphology, food quality, exposure to parasitism, predator, this is just entirely different world for these different guilds. And so I would still say this is more than you would expect, higher flexibility. Now, when we look at insect diversity, then what is clear is that beetles are dominating everything. They are by far the most species diverse order. And so there is a famous quotation from Haldane, who was a famous biologist, but also theologian. And so when they ask him what his study can tell about the mind of the creator, then he said rather amusingly that it's an inordinate fondness for beetles, which we can derive as a theologian from observing nature. And so there has always been the question why there are so many beetles. Of course, I have to say that although beetles remain to be the most species-rich order, the balance of diversity is changing a little bit with recent advances in molecular biology, because with massive barcoding of all tiny insects flying around us, we are actually finding huge numbers of very tiny parasitoid wasps, Hymenoptera, and also a huge number of boring flies, especially the saprophages flies. And entomologists were sort of afraid of dealing with these tiny parasitoids and were really not interested in all the flies feeding in the muck. And so it's only now where we can sensibly deal with them, and we are finding huge diversity of these. But still, beetles are number one. And when you look at the association with angiosperms for herbivorous beetles, then this is a bit old study, 1998, that was really the start of the serious phylogeny. So we can find more advanced studies now, but this is a nice illustration of the principle. When we suspect that, for instance, association with angiosperm has effect on increasing diversity of that lineage, then if we are lucky and there are repeated switching between angiosperms and other hosts, we can explore these and look at sister lineages, which in beetles happens at least 5 times. And so we have always one lineage continuing with angiosperms and other having either cycads or conifers. And in all cases, when you look at number of species, the switch to angiosperms produces higher diversity. So it's getting fairly convincing argument that this is one of the aspects of beetle diversity. Another question we can have about speciation of in this case herbivores, for instance, is whether the host specific lineages are speciating faster or slower than more generalist ones. That relates again to explaining, we want to explain not only why some lineages, some taxa are species diverse, but also we want to explain why there are so many narrow host specific insects. And we can say that it may be advantageous ecologically, and we have discussed that extensively in previous lecture, or we can also look at the phylogenetic dynamics. If being a generalist or being a specialist is equally advantageous when you are in the field and living your life, if the specialists are generating species faster and these are again specialists, while generalists are generating mostly generalists, but at a slower rate, then naturally by mere phylogenetical dynamics, you will end up with a higher number of specialists. So this is an important question. And this is a survey of proportion of speciation events which happened either from generalist to specialist or from specialist to generalist. These are transitions. Another question will be how fast are generalists speciating within generalists and specialists generating other specialists. So this will be the second part of the picture. But these transitions looks like there is not a huge imbalance. There is some slight preference to the blue part of the picture. So that means switching from generalist to specialist, which was basically expected. When you think about it, it's always easier to get more and more specialized. That's why most of scientists also end up hugely specialized. But once you are a specialist or something, then becoming a generalist again is very stressful and difficult in science. And the same goes for herbivores and their host plants. Also, when we consider phylogenetical dynamics, we have to look at speciation and also at extinction. And so again, there is a fair assumption that specialists are more prone to extinction, because if your host plant is gone, then you know, that's it. And this seems to be the case. This is the mass extinction at the boundary of Cretaceous and Tertiary, that so-called KT boundary. And some of these insect herbivores are leaving their marks on the fossilized leaves, you know, the leaf damage, and it's gill specific. So you can tell whether you are looking at the herbivory by an external feeder, a leaf roller, galler or miner. And these gills have different level of specialization. Gallers are narrowly specialized, miners also, and so on. Others are less specialized. So we can tell actually whether these extinctions were specialists or not based on the type of the damage. And it looks like it was by and large specialists who suffered extinction in this mass Cretaceous Tertiary event. Okay, we can look also from the broader perspective on the innovation in invertebrate herbivores. The number of insect families is increasing throughout the evolution. Well, that's partly how we classify them. We can argue that when something is 250 million years old, then at least based on fossil evidence rather than molecular phylogenies, we really don't have the detailed data which would separate different families. But on the broader perspective, we can also look at major inventions of different mouth parts, because with insects we have a lot of different chewing systems. We have licking, we have sucking, and that can be different morphologically depending whether you are blood sucking or xylem or phloem sucking from plants. And so when we look at the major systems of mouth parts, we can classify them to five different types, and we can see that evolution basically finished 150 million years ago. We have no major new mouth parts in insects for more than 100 million years. Again, nowadays with big phylogenies, we can have real fun mapping all kinds of ecological traits on big phylogenies and looking either whether they are associated, correlated together once we filter out phylogeny, or how flexible different lifestyles. So again, this is big phylogeny of insects, and we are looking with different colors on the larval feeding in insects, what major category from these lists they belong to, and how flexible they are. So we can have a look also how phylogenetically this is also sort of a race of which lineages will be speciating fastest, and therefore increasing their relative share in the evolution. So it looks like, for instance, phytophagy is currently second and has been more or less in the second place all the time. So it's just keeping pace with overall diversification and so on. Okay, we have been talking now a lot about the insect herbivores, but there are of course also large vertebrate herbivores, especially mammals, and also especially in frugivores, birds and others. And there we have to be conscious of the fact that we are looking at very unnatural ecosystems, because there has been a huge extinction of megafauna at all continents except for Africa. So basically, we are going to safaris to Africa because that's the only continent which is more or less left with megafauna. And unfortunately, all these extinctions were a human caused. When humans were colonizing the continents, then first thing they did was to get rid of a huge number of species of large vertebrates, especially mammals. This has been a bit controversial topic because lots of people see indigenous communities as really connected with nature, and it's a bit hard to swallow that they actually cause more vertebrate extinctions than entire technological civilization in the last 5,000 years. But unfortunately, it's the case. The alternative explanation that it was climate change is not really plausible, also because the extinction is timed more or less with the colonization of different continents or big islands. So for instance, the Madagascar, New Zealand fauna went extinct last because they were colonized last. The American ones was before that, and Australia was earlier. And so we have this sequence. And also the extinction was curiously size specific. Yeah, these are extinctions of percentage of genera of mammals with different body sizes, and pretty much the small genera were saved because they were not subject of hunting. So here you can see in a green are the surviving megafauna, and in black is a recently extinct one. And so except for Africa, especially South America is complete disaster, and also the Australia New Guinea region as well. So we are already living in a very distorted ecosystems. That of course, the big megafauna has effects also on other parts of the ecosystem. So for instance, according to one suggestion, there are plants with large fruits which are specially adapted to this megafauna, and for instance gomphotheres, which are among the extinct mammals in South America, now left their partner plants with difficulties in reproducing, because suddenly they have nobody to disperse them. This role is actually very conspicuous in forest elephants in Africa, which are of course unfortunately surviving. Okay, so we have finished the phylogenetical considerations for herbivory.